Hello, this is Phil Simon for the Huffington Post, and I'm pleased today to be joined by the extremely successful, extremely smart Dorie Clark, author of Reinventing You, Define Your Brand, Imagine Your Future. Dorie, how are you doing today?
I'm great. Thanks very much. It's great to be talking with you, Phil.
Good deal. Good deal. You have been blowing up lately, and most of it, I think, is due to a lot of hard work, but also your book has been really successful in personal branding. It's funny. People will tell me that I'm really good at it, and I don't really have this sort of background. Is this something that you have worked with for a long time or just sort of fell into it? I mean, what was the impetus for writing the book?
Well, the impetus for writing the book, ultimately, it started because I wrote in late 2010 a blog post for Harvard Business Review called How to Reinvent Your Personal Brand. And that was really drawn from my own personal experience. I had been a reporter, a presidential campaign spokesperson. I ran a nonprofit, made a documentary film. So I'd done all these things, and I realized that along the way, I needed to be very strategic about how I was communicating my identity and what I was doing now, or else other people just, you know, it was going to go over their head. They were going to think of me in whatever I was doing 5 years ago, which was not very helpful. So I really realized that I needed to take control of my personal brand at that point. So I wrote this blog post. It seemed to resonate, and HBR asked me if I would turn it into a magazine piece, about 2,500 words for them. And when it came out, I feel very lucky that I had the opportunity to turn it into a book, Reinventing You. Because I think it's, you know, not just me, more and more people, almost everyone these days, has to reinvent themselves and in the process really understand what your brand is and how you can communicate that to the world.
Mm-hmm. And it's hard to argue with that. I think most people would agree. But one of the things that I really liked about your book is that it isn't just a series of 30,000 foot proclamations, do this, don't do that. You really weave in a lot of different stories, which I really enjoy. Was that by design or just when you did your research, did you discover that there maybe was a better way of telling the story rather than just preaching? You have a show me, don't tell me approach that I really like.
Yeah, thank you, Phil. It's true. In the course of writing Reinventing You, I interviewed probably 50 executives, and so many of their stories are captured in the book. For me, I really agree with you. I feel like when you read a business book, you just have a list of rules and best practices and, you know, regulations. It's not going to stick. It's not going to be that helpful for you. For me, what I always enjoyed as a reader of business books is really interesting, engaging stories about how people tried new things or how they changed their lives and were able to do it. That's the kind of thing that it gets me thinking about, you know, gee, how can I apply that in my own life? Or, oh, wait, I should try what he did. And I wanted to be able to provide that to the reader as well. So there's stories in there about a poet who becomes a management consultant, stories about a woman who was a legal scholar who became a wine expert. So a lot of fun transitions, and also people who worked, you know, loved their job, wanted to keep at it, but realized that in the process, they needed to make sure that other people really recognized what their true capabilities were. And so we tell those stories as well.
Is that what you mean when you talk about strategic moonlighting?
Yeah, strategic moonlighting. It's one of the concepts that I cover in the book. And basically what I mean by that is that when you're making a change in your life, you know, some kind of a transition, whether it is changing careers entirely or maybe shifting a little bit so that you can position yourself for the kind of job or promotion that you want, you don't want to just jump off of a cliff. I mean, it's a risky thing to do in any point in time, but especially with the economy the way that it is. You need to be careful. And so what I suggest is that in strategic moonlighting, you keep at whatever you're doing now, you keep your day job, but you're strategic about the fact that you realize, okay, I need to gather new skills. I need to learn new things. Maybe if you're starting a new business, you need to build up a little bit of a client base. So you start practicing it and learning and experimenting on the side on your own time when the risks are low and you can fail safely. And once you do that, you put yourself in a position so that when you make the move, ultimately, you're able to be successful.
It's funny that you mentioned that because unconsciously in 2008, I think that's exactly what I was doing. I was consulting for a company in New York, and then I would come home and I would be working on my first book. It would have been really, I think, risky for me to just quit cold turkey and spend 6 months or a year writing, but I've actually embraced that kind of, I call them adjacent lines of businesses. If you start consulting, then maybe you write about it. If you write, then maybe you can speak. If you speak, maybe you can do some other things related to that. And those are all transferable skills, which I know you're a big fan of and you make a point of in the book. Why are they so important today?
Well, I think transferable skills are really particularly critical today because industries are changing so fast. I mean, I was just meeting with a friend earlier today who's an academic, and she's not sure if she'll get tenure. And as a result, she has to say to herself, all right, she's become a specialist in one very particular niche, as academia requires, but she's having to ask herself, well, what else can I do? Okay, I run a research lab, so I know how to manage people. I've published all these academic papers, so I know how to write. I speak at conferences, so I have public speaking skills. And if you think about those things, rather than, I'm a specialist in, this particular small thing, then your world opens up. Because it means that if you get foiled, if your industry changes, if you don't get the job that you want, it's not just hitting a wall and then saying, oh, I guess I failed. You're able to pivot and move into other things because you understand that your skills can be of use in a new context.
Mm-hmm. One of the other interesting notions in the book is this one of a mini-MBA. I never heard that before. Can you explain that for the listeners?
Yeah, one of the stories that I tell in the book, which you were mentioning earlier, is about a guy named Dave Cutler, who caught my attention. I met him through a mutual friend, but he had become something of a media celebrity a few years ago because he needed a job, and he started a very clever social media campaign in order to get a job. He was so successful, he got profiled in the local NPR station, the local television, because he was just so much more thorough. I mean, most people would probably, they'll put a post on Facebook, hey, I'm looking for a job, anybody got anything? But this guy created his own job search app that, downloaded all of his blog posts and videos of him. He created a Foursquare check-in for his job search. He had a QR code on his resume. He really went crazy. But part of where he learned to do all this is that Rutgers University in New Jersey has what they call a mini-MBA program. It's basically a week-long boot camp in social media, but it was just what he needed. He felt it was a very positive experience because instead of going back, spending 2 years to get an MBA, which a professional father of two, in his case, really couldn't afford the time or the money to do, this was something that let him interact with active professionals in the social media realm, kicked his skills up a notch, gave him a credential of some kind to say, hey, he's at least invested enough time and energy to want to learn more about social media. And it gave him some good ideas that he used in his job search.
It reminds me a little bit of the guy, I forget his name, but this was maybe 18 months ago. He was also looking for a job, and he created a resume that looked exactly like an Amazon page. Have you heard of this one?
No, that's great.
It's fantastic. It had the same fonts, the same colors, and instead of... for the reviews, they'd have recommendations. And I'll try to embed the link in the post, but it was absolutely brilliant. I'm sure you can Google it. But just a really creative way of saying to people, I'm available and I'm not approaching this in a traditional manner. I know that people like Seth Godin don't believe in resumes. And you actually, Seth's in your book, right?
Yeah.
I have mixed feelings about them. In fact, I was going to give a talk here in Las Vegas, and to make a long story short, they said, where's your resume? And I said, I don't believe in them, and that really ticked them off. As I'm thinking to myself, I like to think that I've got a good website, a good web presence, videos, books, blah, blah, blah. And I just wonder, it depends on the job, but to me, I struggle with resumes because that just means I can conform to rules. And even if you have a resume, I've seen some really cool visual ones recently that show people's skills as a function of time and really graphical. What do you feel about resumes? Is it sort of depend on what you're trying to do?
Yeah, I mean, I have a resume, but it really, it's not something that I try actively to circulate. I give people my resume when they require it. Mm-hmm. And usually the people that require it are people, in my case, in academia, say. If you are looking to teach somewhere, they need to have your resume so they can have your resume on file. That's basically about it. And so it's become this kind of pro forma exercise. No, I don't think anyone in the world is going to hire you based on your resume. We have long passed that. People find you on the web. I actually wrote a blog post for Forbes called Reputation 3.0, the internet is your resume. I firmly believe that. I mean, people are going to Google you, like you said, Phil. They're going to go to your website. They'll watch your videos. That's how people get to know you. So I have a resume. I think it's kind of stupid. If someone makes me give it to them, I'm not going to kick up a huge fuss because it's all part of their bureaucratic process.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I sure as heck wouldn't spend a lot of time on it.
Right. I read a statistic that something like 80% of recruiters these days will Google someone and search social networks before even interviewing them.
Yeah, I hope they do. I wish it was 100%. I mean, what's with these people? I remember hearing that, I think it was in Finland, it's like illegal to Google a job candidate.
No.
What are these people thinking? This is prime information. This is, if someone is too stupid to keep something horrible off the internet, I mean, I don't want to hire that person. You need to know what you're getting. The internet allows you to do that.
Mm-hmm. Justine Sacco should have hired you a couple months ago before she opened her big mouth, as it were.
Oh, goodness. I mean, that's just tragedy because it is 100% self-inflicted. I mean, there's some people that I feel bad for on the internet because, you know, something happened, or maybe
right.
they were a teenager, or maybe it's something they can't control. That one is just, you know, you just shake your head. This is a PR professional. Oy.
Right. We talked before about the benefits of personal branding, but there's, with the internet, no such thing, in my opinion, as permanently deleting something. You delete a tweet, but it's been captured as a screenshot or somebody saved it, whatever.
Snapchat illusion.
Yes. How do you recover from that one? I mean, when you Google Justine Sacco, I would think for the next, 30 years, that's going to be number one, number two, all the way through number 1,000.
Oh, it's so true. Yeah. If you're Justine Sacco, you have one play, literally one play. And all you can do, because you know that everyone's going to know your name, they're going to associate you with that, is that you need to get in front of the story. You need to own it. And you need to make your brand, I'm Justine Sacco. I can teach you about controlling your internet reputation in crisis communications because I messed up in such a profoundly huge way, and here's the lesson that I learned from it. If she's willing to do that, I think people will give her a chance and they'll listen to her. Clearly, she has experience with this. If she just tries to, you know, kind of pretend like it didn't happen. And,
right.
Hey, I'm Justine. I'm looking for a job at your insurance company. Everyone's going to be like...
Right. No, she's definitely speaking from experience. Can you talk a little bit about future writing projects?
Yeah, I am hard at work right now, Phil. I'm probably about 85% done with the first draft of my next book. It's going to be coming out next spring 2015 from Portfolio Penguin. And it is a book about how to become a recognized expert in your field. So I've interviewed a lot of really cool thinkers. You were mentioning Seth Godin earlier. I interviewed him for this book. People like Tom Peters, Robert Cialdini, all the cool folks that are really doing interesting work, and David Allen, and try to essentially reverse engineer the process of how do you come up with interesting and world-changing ideas, and then how do you get recognized for the quality of those ideas and build a following around them.
Interesting stuff. We'll get you out here on this. The symbols in the background, what are they?
Oh, yes. In the background there, I took a trip to China 5 years ago. I have been since then as well, but it was my first trip. And I got these. These are all the sort of, you can only see three of them right now, I think. But they're the four, like, really good things in Chinese. So one is happiness, one is wealth, one is... I don't know, maybe they have a few for wealth. The Chinese are very big on it. Luck, you know, all these. I actually have, sadly I don't read Chinese, so I have what they are written on the back of them, but it's basically like, you know, whoa, good stuff in the Chinese symbology.
My favorite one is, it's I love the duality of it. The same symbol, I believe, in Chinese for opportunity is the one for chaos.
Yeah.
Good deal.
Amen to that.
Well, Dorie, thanks so much for taking time. Best of luck with the writing and the new book, and congrats on all your success.
Phil, thank you so much. Great to talk with you.